Mr. President, Dr. Kwa, ladies and gentlemen, one advantage of living for a longer time than is the average expectancy of life in many countries is that you see things develop over years. My first visit to Singapore was in the late 60s, and thinking back of what all has been achieved in this state, not only in the field of psychiatry, but in many other fields, it is really a delight. It opens the heart. And I want to congratulate not only the government of Singapore, but also the very many people whom I have met over the years who have contributed to this extraordinary successful progress that we have seen. Now, today, I'm going to speak about the training of psychiatrists for the future. It's somewhat easier to speak about what should happen in the future, particularly if you project into the far away future, because you are unlikely to be there when the accounts are put down, so that I can say things that maybe otherwise I wouldn't dare to say. Now, there are some trends in general which I think will shape the psychiatrists of the future. I've listed some of them on this slide. The first of them is the globalization, which of course brought us possibilities to learn and to have access to science and to knowledge from various places, to have materials and a variety of things that come various ways, but also has another impact which perhaps is less often admitted, although in some instances it is extremely disturbing. It's the impact of an imposition of value systems from other lands on the less powerful or the less economically strong. And this impact of globalization, the impact of this imposition of a value system, of course, is very important for us as well. Ideas such as the importance of individuality or the necessity to have everybody independent and so forth, which have come to many countries in the world, have been very foreign to the culture of those countries in earlier times. While most of Asia and a number of other countries elsewhere have been living and thinking about interdependence between people who live in the same territory, they are now forced more and more to accept the notion of independence, of autonomy of individuals, a thing that is contrary to many of the instincts that have been earlier present and disturbs in a significant way, particularly in the field of medicine, when people are sick, the way in which they overcome their illness. Another term that I've written here is the term of de-civilization. I believe, ladies and gentlemen, that a civilization can be measured by the amount of care that a society gives to its feeble members, to the elderly, to children, and to the sick people who are members of that society. And unfortunately, in a number of countries worldwide, we see now a process of de-civilization, of less care being given to those feeble members of the society, all with a current notion of having to make a success and to go forward. It is visible in a variety of indicators, in the suddenly regrowth or re-emerging of high rates of mortality of children, of a decreasing life expectancy late in life. While the life expectancy remained the same over the years, the total life expectancy, the life expectancy at late years has started diminishing because we are not paying sufficient attention to the elderly. And that process of de-civilization is unfortunately also present everywhere. And we'll have to think about it if you think about the psychiatrist who will work in that kind of a setting. Decentralization has been a great disappointment. While in the beginning we were all very happy by the fact that we have decentralized services, for example, it has become less and less acceptable because in many countries the decentralization has happened in a curious and degenerated way. It has been a decentralization of responsibility without a decentralization of authority, so that now the decentralization has led to the fact that people of the periphery are responsible for things, but the decision about money which they get to do those things is still retained at the center, leading to an increased feeling of dissatisfaction. And burnout has been described in many countries as being the most serious epidemic in healthcare, with a massive flight of people from the peripheral services elsewhere. Peripheral services who go then into either into another profession or drive taxis or do various other things because they cannot stand this constant feeling of powerlessness with a great amount of responsibility which lies on their shoulders. Another term that has come and been promoted by the World Bank is the word commoditification. It's a terrible word. Even the English language, which otherwise supports very long words, is not very happy with that one. It's really the bank which has said, and many have accepted it, that everything is a commodity. Health is a commodity, like sugar or cotton or wood, timber. Everything is a commodity, which means that you can buy it and you can sell it. And the more you pay, the more you get. And the less you pay, the less you get. And this commoditification of medicine has led a different attitude to the field of health. Health as such, providing health and looking after people who are not well, is an ethical imperative. It is not economic commodity. Yet, we are now more and more impressed. And when you think about the way in which the programs are being written, the first argument that is very often put forward is, we shall save money if we do this, that, or the other. Rather than to appeal to some higher goals that you might consider important, sufficiently important to promote them, regardless of their cost. It's, of course, nice to save money, but at the same time, certain goals are not linked to money. The cheapest way of dealing with chronic illness is to shoot people who are mentally ill. That is very cheap, but it is far from being in any way compatible, harmonious, with what we would like to think about health care as such, which really tries to help members of the society, regardless of their state, and even if it does cost us money, which will not necessarily result in economic gains. Two other changes that I think are important. One is the sudden urbanization, and urbanization in towns and in countries which have previously not known this. Singapore, of course, has been a champion in urbanization for a long time, but countries such as Argentina, for example, have now reached the top. The most urbanized country in the world is Argentina. 87% of the total population lives in towns. And in many other countries, the same is happening. In Mongolia, 70% of the people live in towns. The world as such is becoming an urban world. But our health services and principles of primary health care, for example, are all written for rural areas and are not, in fact, adjusted to this curious setting in which urbanization is happening rapidly with the disruption of connections between people and with a different style of organization of life which is not incorporated into our strategies for health care. The changes of the middle class are important, particularly maybe and more so in Asia than elsewhere. The middle class in the developed countries has been continuously diminishing and weakening. There's a beautiful book under a rather pornographic title that has just come out in the United States. It's called Screwed. And it refers both to the screwing in terms of a screw and in other ways. And basically it says that the middle class in the United States and a number of European countries has continuously been pressured into less and less so that the total size has become lesser, that people who today get married cannot really afford to send their child to the schooling to which only 15 years ago they could still do, and a number of other things. Now the diminution of the middle class generally leads to a lesser support to moral rules that have prevailed in a society. Its increase of the middle class changes the situation. In a developing country, the situation is opposite. You get today in a developing country a huge increase in the middle class. Today in a country like India, there are more middle class citizens than in the United States of America. Huge numbers, which are not any longer so happy with having a healthcare system that is shaped in the form of a primary health care. They'd like something else. So what happens is a very large, very rapid growth of private health care of very high quality with a neglect of the rest of the population who lives in pseudo-primary health care of extremely poor quality. So that you get a medicine at two speeds in developing countries, which in fact shows to the poor that the rich, their own brothers, have a fantastic system of health care for which they can pay, while they get less and less, with less and less effect to their health. Not only has the society changed, but also we see that trends in medicine are becoming more and more prominent. We are now finding ourselves, at least I, in curious conflicts. I just give you here a few examples. The idea of letting people die was something that was an anathema when I was a medical student. The notion that anybody could be helped to die, that somebody has a right to die when ill, is something that has been completely foreign to what we have done in our time. Yet, it is becoming an accepted notion to consider. In Oregon, euthanasia has been voted as one of the ways of providing medical care. And in fact, the population has voted for a 500 conditions to see how important for them euthanasia might be. For them, euthanasia is on the 184th place. Appendicitis is on number one place, and psychiatric disorders are over 400. So for them, it's much more important to think about that. And this is a change in medical ethics which disturbs us profoundly, because so many of our people with whom we are working are not only continuously speaking about suicide, but also communicatively do this in act. Then there is also the question, our continuous dilemma between should we become more humane in our handling of patient care or more efficient? Efficiency will, in fact, reduce the time with the person who is sick, while if you want to do proper care, it will extend the time. It will be more humane, but more expensive. And we are constantly trying to find a compromise between those two trends. And we also have these curious notions that have previously not been present. In the 1970s, it was completely impossible to introduce opiates into the treatment of chronic pain because at the time it was the fear of addiction was one that really governed the medical establishment. As time went by, we have become more and more aware of the fact that quality of life takes the upper hand in many of the medical interventions, and that stilling pain and dealing with it in an appropriate way may be much more important than being afraid of addiction, particularly when such a thing happens at the end of one's life. And then, of course, there are numerous changes between patients and doctors, with which I don't need to spend much time. Patients who know more than their doctors because they follow their disease on the internet and know much more about modern diseases than doctors might know, and a number of other changes that we have seen, which is a huge increase of popularity of alternative medicine, the only medicine that still talks to people. In France, there are today more alternative medicine practitioners than medical doctors trained in Western schools, about 95,000 of them. And there are villages in Switzerland in which you have up to 1,000 traditional healers. And you go in there and you are listened by one and you go to another one and they touch you and they do curious things like listen to you. They ask you. They seem to be interested. They don't write prescriptions while they listen to you and things of this kind. All of it somehow indicating the disadvantages of dehumanized medicine, which people consider less and less satisfactory. We see that the epidemic of burnout in medical personnel is becoming extremely widespread, more so in people who deal with chronic care and working on the periphery. In Switzerland, which is a country that has very well developed healthcare system, the most popular courses of all are courses on the prevention of burnout, and the only course in which you have a waiting list for up to 6 months is ways for doctors how to prevent staff from having burnout syndromes, because they are deafened and deadened by the current system in which they seem to be getting so little satisfaction out of their work and have so many things to do about which they cannot do sufficiently. And then we have the other processes of our continuous repetition of strategies of healthcare which have no longer are adequate. Community care in countries in which there is no community, in which the only community which exists is an electronic community, in which your friends are thousands of kilometers away, and you don't even know the name of your neighbor who is now supposed to look after you when you're sick. things of this kind, which really mean that we should have to reshape the entire medicine if you really wanted to have strategies that work. Sometimes we invent things which we think are very clever, and because we forget that only 15 years ago we've been criticizing them. One of the greatest obstacles, one of the greatest objections to medicine in the Soviet Union has been what is called taking patients on the account. This was a system by which a person with schizophrenia or other serious mental illness, when he came to the doctor, was written into the register of the facility, and he was told to come back for checkup, and if he didn't come back, then somebody was sent to his home. He went to his home, tried to see him, tried to convince him that he should get treatment. If he didn't want, they put him back into hospital and treated him there. It was terribly criticized, being seen as a true negation of human rights. About 10, 15 years ago, there is a reemergence of what is now called assertive outreach treatment, in which the greatest advantage is that you are allowed to go after patients after they have not accepted treatment. A curious forgetting of the various concerns which we had about human rights in psychiatry only a few years ago. Now, a discipline, any discipline, is defined by three facts. One, what are the problems that this discipline has to deal with? Two, what are the methods that discipline may use to deal with those problems? And three, how long should the practitioners be trained in order to be able to use those methods? This defines a discipline. And unfortunately, ladies and gentlemen, the discipline of psychiatry has a very poor record in that respect. We should first have to agree on what are we in fact working with, and that is at present not so terribly clear. Are grief reactions our business or not? When people come to us for advice, whom should we treat? What is the so-called sub-threshold disorder? If somebody comes along with a mental disorder that lasts 12 days instead of 14, are we allowed to treat him? And why are we not paid if we do it? Sub-threshold disorders, as you know, are not being reimbursed in many countries. And we have no certainty, because there is a dilemma before us. Classifications such as the DSM say that in order for a condition to be considered a mental health problem, that is a disorder, you must have three characteristics. One, it must have certain symptoms. Two, it must cause distress. And three, it must cause functional impairment or disability. If those three are not present, it's not a disorder. But what do we do with all those people who come along severely distressed but not enough symptoms? Or people who come along who are neither disabled nor distressed but have many symptoms? 4% of the population of the Netherlands hears voices. Are they sick? They don't seem to be sick. They work very well. They make their living. And now you say Netherlands. But it's not the Netherlands. In Japan, I've just recently spoken to Mr. Sato, who is the head of a rather large organization of people who hear voices. There are many of them. We don't ask in many countries how many people hear voices or have delusions and other severe symptoms, but they are there. Yet they seem to be functioning in society. Are they disorders who should be treated? Or are they not? They don't have distress, and they don't seem to be impaired. Are they sick, or are they not sick? Equally so, the ICD is trying, the International Classification of Diseases says, no, we should divide those three characteristics and assess them separately. We should think of symptoms, we should think about disability, and distress. And any one of the three being present should be sufficient to justify your intervention. A person with a severe distress, if he comes to you for any reason, because he's distressed for any reason, should be given some help, even though he doesn't have psychiatric symptoms, even though he doesn't have a functional impairment. Now, at present, we don't have an agreement between those, and we should, in the very near future, agree what are we considering a disorder and which are the disorders that belong into psychiatry and not to some other discipline, like nephrology, for example. Sorry about that example. Now, the second problem is concerning the methods of psychiatry. Not only do we not know for sure where did disorders of psychiatry end and problems of daily living start, we do not know for sure where does a disease, a neurological disease with a psychiatric symptom begin or stop. So we do not know for sure what is our area of work. We also not quite sure which are our methods, because we are using many methods which have never been demonstrated to be effective, starting from a variety of psychotherapeutic methods with psychoanalytic orientation, which for today we still do not have definitely proven to be of particular usefulness. And then you go to a whole range of other methods. The European countries have got together to write a pact about mental health. And in that pact, the first major presentation has been by the Princess of Denmark, by the Prince of Belgium, who came along to tell us about the method of treatment that she really wants to promote on a European level, and it's swimming with dolphins. Now, the dolphins seem to be all right, and it seems that some of the people who were swimming with dolphins were feeling a little bit better because of it. But she says, well, we don't really know, and it's very difficult to assess how much an improvement there was, etc. It was a lot, and everybody in this hall, huge hall, was saying, well, maybe we should try that. Maybe it's a useful thing. And I give you this example, as many other examples exist, of treatments that we consider as being within our scheme. At least we don't shout against them. Riding horses for children with autism, like so-called the hippotherapy, or maybe Zen psychotherapy, or Tao psychotherapy, that is particularly, or being silent for 2 or 3 days as being what is called a silent therapy. And I could go on for a long time to tell you about treatments that are acceptable and done by psychiatrists. And for all that are done, there are very few treatments in psychiatry that really have the mark of being properly assessed for their efficacy. And we should somehow become aware of that and do something about it. Of course, one has to realize that some of the methods of psychiatry must be used in other disciplines for other purposes. For example, the principle of debriefing may well be a useful therapeutic method that is used for people who don't have a mental disorder. So both ways, we should be clear about what are the methods that belong in our field and how we should assess them. Not only do we not have a perfect clarity about what our disorders are, we are also not quite sure what methods are used, and therefore we are not quite sure how long we should train people. Dr. Deva will bear me out. Training in psychiatry in Mongolia lasts 3 months. And after that, since you are working in a psychiatric hospital, you are called a psychiatrist, not too logical. And if you have a little bit of time, after 2 years, you spend another period of 3 months and another period, and so after a while, you become a psychiatrist with a considerable experience. And in some other countries, the training in psychiatry lasts 7 years. What kind of discipline are we in which we can vary a training period for our treatment methods that varies between 3 months and 7 years? What kind of a definition is this? And I think of great importance would be our reaching a consensus which treatments there are and how long it takes to learn them and be competent in using them. So we have not only that, forget that what we should have, look a little bit at the current disharmonies that exist in psychiatry. First, there is a disharmony between training that we have and the tasks that future psychiatrists will have to do. Then there is a disharmony between the competence of teachers who have learned their job 50 years ago or 30 years ago and the teaching which they have to give today in all disciplines. And then there is also a disharmony between the purpose of the training and the purpose of the product. Here is what I would expect would be the minimal requirements for the training of a psychiatrist, particularly in a developing country. He must know how to manage because he will soon be ruling and running a particular department. He should have the capacity to advise the government about policy formulation. He should know what to do with forensic cases. He should be able to teach other categories of personnel. he should be able to advocate for his patients and for psychiatry as a discipline. He should be able to do some research. This is what he should be doing, as well as clinical work. But at present, while he should know all of these things, the only thing that he gets in most of the countries of the world is, in fact, some instruction on clinical work, and this instruction is done by the what one would call the guru-chela relationship. You look what the others are doing, and then you do the same. And after a while, you are almost as bad as your teacher. It's a, or as good, depending on the teacher, of course. So that in many ways, these very important things which people will learn later, need later, they have to learn by themselves. They have to discover ways of managing. Although we know that many people will go to be directors of hospitals, we are really not giving them a chance to learn how to prevent stealing, or how to do budgets, or how to do government proposals, or how to plan, how to evaluate, how to assure quality, a number of other things. So our the total of our knowledge that we are putting at their disposal is insufficient. And then we would also have to give them more skills. Here is a list of skills which we are not providing in sufficient numbers. We don't sufficiently pay attention to communication skills. There are very few curricula in psychiatry that teach you how to listen well. It's a very difficult task, maybe the most useful skill in psychiatry. The skills that are necessary for these other tasks about which maybe you could get some information. Training skills, that is learning how to teach, what to use in order to teach, some training in what one would traditionally have called pedagogics, training in management, and all of these skills can never be learned if you teach them in dry things. They would have to be learned by doing them, and very few departments of psychiatry in the world are in fact offering that. So ladies and gentlemen, I think that the main tasks that we should be thinking about is we should first reach an agreement on what is the discipline of psychiatry, how far do we go. And that just having done so, the curricula toward the current and the future tasks of our psychiatrists. We should spend a lot of time to enhance the competence of our teachers, which are now falling behind, because there is a tremendous development of knowledge. And we have this dilemma. Should we have teachers who each know something very well, or can we still maintain the idea of comprehensive teachers who know enough of everything to teach, to really be leaders of the teaching? I think that, in conclusion, I want to say that I see, despite of these problems, the future as being extremely bright and very challenging and foreseeable. And I think that we have to think of ways in which we can change the training of psychiatrists now so that in the future they not only be useful, but also make psychiatry a very important central discipline that can help people the world over. Thank you.